Hello everyone and welcome to Metro Matters. I'm Mary Sitt. Imagine an electric bus powered by a battery which allows the bus to run for 30 miles without a charge. Well, Metro is scheduled to test an electric bus built by Proterra. Here to tell us more is Lauren Cochran, Director of Innovation at Metro. She oversees Metro's research and outreach to identify and pilot new ideas and technologies that improve our mobility and customer service. Lauren, welcome to Metro Matters.
Thank you. Happy to be here.
Thanks for being here. Now, tell me how an electric bus works.
An electric bus is different than a conventionally powered bus in that it doesn't have an engine, it has batteries. There's no engine, so no oil change,
no pistons,
much quieter, yeah. No. And so it's powered basically by lithium titanate batteries that let the bus go for 30 miles, as you said, on a single charge.
How big is this battery?
You have to have ton of batteries to propel a 40-foot transit bus.
Okay.
So think of a toothbrush or something that recharges and how tiny that battery is. This is a transit bus, so lots of batteries. However, this is the lightest weight bus in the transit industry right now, and that's because instead of a steel body frame, it has a non-conductive body made of carbon fiber, and so it's lightweight.
So for the customer, an electric bus would be much quieter than a regular bus?
That's right, yes, because there is no engine.
Is the ride smoother?
The ride...
The same?
I think the ride would probably be the same. It is the same, but there is reduced noise because uh-huh. there isn't an engine. And there's zero tailpipe emissions as well.
Oh, that's very nice. So it's a green bus.
That's right. It's a green bus.
How does it compare to all the other kinds of buses, like let's say a diesel bus, compressed natural gas bus, or hybrid, in terms of its environmental impact?
A battery electric bus is the only zero tailpipe emission vehicle.
Okay.
So while a compressed natural gas bus does have reduced emissions over a diesel bus,
mm-hmm.
Battery electric is still the cleanest. Now, okay. that said, we now have ultra-low sulfur diesel buses in the Metro fleet, and so combined with our hybrid buses, our CNG buses, and now piloting this electric bus, they are all better for the environment than just a dirty diesel
bus.
Can
you see a day when either this agency or another agency would go all electric, every single bus?
Absolutely,
electric?
Yeah.
Is that happening anywhere
it
now?
It is happening.
Where?
Foothill Transit in West Covina, California has committed to having an all-electric fleet. The cost of fuel is such a large line item in a transit agency budget. When you can reduce that significantly by using electricity, which is much cheaper, you have a bus that has 37% fewer parts mm-hmm. than a conventionally powered bus.
37 fewer parts? So it's much easier to maintain them,
that's
right?
That's right, yes. It ends up being a cost savings for the agency.
Now, it sounds like transit agencies are really jumping on the bandwagon for the electric bus. Why aren't consumers doing this with electric cars? You know, it's still not
yeah.
that common, and people aren't, even with the rebates and all this stuff going on, tax rebates.
I can't answer that. Only to say that I think one of the biggest deterrents, if you mm-hmm. will, to electric vehicle use is range anxiety. People still feel like there isn't a charging station on every corner, right? Like there is with a gas station. And so the truth of the matter is we don't really, most of our trips that we make in our personal vehicles aren't that long. We're not driving 400 miles on a single charge. Yeah. We're making small errands throughout the day and we're commuting. But when we think about our cars and the traditional way of fueling our vehicles, that leads to range anxiety. So I would say that that's probably still the number one.
I like
one,
that phrase, range anxiety.
Yeah, that's probably still the number yeah. one inhibitor to wider adoption.
Because we see gas stations on every corner practically,
yes.
but we don't see charging stations everywhere.
That's right.
So it makes us nervous.
Yep.
Now, how do we know this bus really will go 30 miles without a charge? And what if it doesn't? Will the passengers be stranded?
No. All federally funded vehicles uh-huh. go through something called Altoona Testing, where they test the bus in Pennsylvania,
uh-huh.
both with passengers on board and without passengers. And so.
And they do it in Altoona, Pennsylvania?
Yes, in okay. a test environment, I think this bus has gone 40 miles on a single charge with
okay.
fully seated passenger capacity. If for some reason the operator has a panel in front of them that shows them the state of charge.
Mm-hmm.
So just like you look at your cell phone and you can see, oh, I've got 40% battery life left, same thing. So the operator would have forewarning if the battery was depleted to a scary state of charge.
Okay.
But if for some reason that happened, Proterra is giving us a portable charger that'll be mounted on the back of a truck, where the truck could come out just like a service truck would change a tire on a bus. The truck could come out and meet the bus and recharge it while it was en route.
So there's an extra security blanket there.
There is.
Okay, we need to take a little break right now, but we'll be right back with more from Lauren Cochran, our go-to expert on electric buses. Stay with us.
My name is Zach. My mom works, so I ride Metro's 52 to school every day. I'm the drum major for Cashmere High School's Thunder Soul Marching Band. Every time I hit the field, it's like a dream. I just feed off the energy. But my real dream is to go from the Thunder Soul to the Ocean of Soul at TSU. And Metro's gonna take me there. I'm Zach, and this is my Metro.
Welcome to Metro's transportation network and your new traffic and commute solution. Whether you choose bus or train, riding Metro is as easy as 1, 2, 3. 1, plan your trip. The Metro Trip Planner is your one-stop shop for using Metro services. Just enter your starting point, then your destination, and the Trip Planner does all the rest. 2, pay your fare. Metro local bus and light rail fares cost just $1.25 each way. You can pay your fare using cash, the Metro Q Fare Card, or Metro Day Pass. Always on the go? Now you can pay your fare with the new Metro Q mobile ticketing app. It's free and available now via your app store. And 3, get ready to go. Once you've planned your trip and purchased your fare, all that's left to do is get up, get on board, and go. Learn more about Metro by visiting ridemetro.org or call 713-635-4000 for details. Travel the ride way with Metro.
This season, make a break for the action and catch the excitement of Houston Cougar football. If you've got a ticket to one of our 2016 home games or a UH student ID, then you've got a free ride to and from TDECU Stadium on Metrorail.
This season, our Cougs are unstoppable, so don't miss a second of the action. Wear red and ride Metro. It's a free pass.
We've been talking to Lauren Cochran, Director of Innovation at Metro, our go-to expert on electric buses. Metro is scheduled to have one on the road this December on the 63 Fondren route. Lauren, why did we choose this particular route for the electric bus?
We chose this particular route for a few reasons, the first of which is the distance of the route. So it's about 9 miles each direction. It runs north from the Missouri City Park and Ride up to Westheimer, turns around and comes back. So that's perfect because this bus can go about 30 miles on a single charge. And so it's actually able to do what we call opportunity charging, which means that when it comes back to the Missouri City Park and Ride at a layover, passengers are boarding and alighting, the bus can recharge en route. And so what's neat about that is that if this is a 20-hour a day route, the bus can operate for 20 hours a day and recharge en route. The other reason we chose this route is because it's our second highest ridership line with about 5,000 customers per day.
Wow.
And so we wanted to test this bus in heavy transit service. We didn't want to put it on a line that maybe has lower ridership. We really wanted to put it through its paces.
Would the weight of the passengers like affect the, you know, battery charge? Like if you have a fuller bus with more people on it and it weighs more?
Yes.
It does affect it.
But the 30-mile range is with full seated passenger capacity.
But are we fatter in the South?
We might be. We'll include that in our analysis.
Because so far, it's like it's from California, right? We think of people in California running on the beach, maybe a little more fitter with the Hollywood thing.
We'll include that in our analysis.
So the buses can just charge right during a layover while they're sitting at the parking ride lot. How long does it take to charge a bus?
It takes it can go from 0 to 90% charge in fewer than 10 minutes.
That's fast. I wish our cell phones did that.
There we go, me too.
So in 10 minutes.
Essentially, yes. But each time it comes through the transit center, since it's only going, you know, 9 miles up, 9 miles back, it'll just top off, essentially.
Okay. So does the driver have to, you know, plug something in, or do you push a button, or can you tell me the logistics of how to charge a bus?
It's really easy. The operator, it doesn't require any operator intervention. In fact, this bus is partially autonomous, And so when the charging station and the bus recognize each other just using Bluetooth technology, the bus automatically slows down and aligns underneath the charge arm. And the only thing the operator has to do is apply the parking brake and the bus begins to charge.
Really?
That's it.
That's very easy.
Mm-hmm.
Now, could only that particular bus charge on that station, or can other cars, electric cars, who happen to be there?
Only the electric bus.
Okay.
And so the charging station and the bus are smart in that the charging station is looking for the bus and the bus is looking for the charging station. So charging arm will not start charging anything else other than the bus.
Okay, so what kind of analysis has there been done about how much electricity is used and how much, you know, we pay for that versus fuel for that same route? Mm-hmm. Have you guys done that kind of analysis?
Yeah, there's been a lot of analysis done, particularly by the National Renewable Energy Laboratory, mm-hmm. or NREL. They've done a study on some of the early deployments of electric buses. And really the best way to compare it in terms that people understand is fuel economy. And okay. So the electric bus gets about 22 miles per gallon if it were to use conventional fuel.
Okay.
Whereas one of our diesel or hybrid buses gets 3 to 4 miles per gallon on a single tank of gas, if you will.
Okay, so would you like to see the entire fleet electric?
Absolutely. Yeah, I think there are so many benefits to electric. Uh-huh. It's the noise reduction, the reduction in emissions, in a congested city like Houston, I would love to see these proliferate throughout our fleet and throughout the transit industry.
Now, Lauren, this is not your first time dealing with electric bus. You did this back in Los Angeles County. Tell me about that experience. In fact, you deployed the first electric bus, right?
That's right, yes.
Tell me about that.
So in 2009, the Foothill Transit, which is the second largest municipal operator in Los Angeles County, received a grant from the Federal Transit Administration to deploy the first 3 battery electric heavy duty buses into transit service. And so I worked on that project, and it was one of the most exciting things I've ever done. And so to see these buses now all over the country is just, it's just amazing.
What were the challenges back then? Because those were really the early days.
Yeah,
of it.
So that was really the alpha test for mm-hmm. this technology. Mm-hmm. And the challenges, surprisingly, were not related to the technology. The technology performed flawlessly. Mm-hmm. The challenges were bus stuff. You know, the doors wouldn't open. We had windshield wiper problems. The technology performed really well, and so it was promising from the start.
Now, is there only one manufacturer making this, the Proterra people?
No, there are multiple manufacturers. There's BYD, mm-hmm. Which is a Chinese company. Mm-hmm. They've just opened a U.S. headquarters, I think, in California. There's Nova Bus, New Flyer, okay. So and then there's a company called Complete Coachworks, which retrofits a diesel bus into a battery electric bus.
Is this a new model, the Proterra one that Metro's going to be testing?
It is not a new model. It's the 30-foot fast charge bus. Their newest model, excuse me, it's not 30 feet, it's 40 feet. It's the 40-foot fast uh-huh. charge bus. Their newest model is an extended range vehicle that goes farther than the 30 miles on a single charge, has more batteries.
Now you work in a fairly new office for Metro, the Office of Innovation. Mm-hmm. Tell me what your vision is for that office and what you hope to innovate.
My vision for the office really is just to keep improving mobility and to keep making transit attractive for customers. And so whether that's using technology to enhance the customer experience or just thinking of new and different ways of doing things, that's the role I see for the Office of Innovation. The word I use is incubate. We are the incubators of new and good ideas here at Metro.
Okay. Lauren, thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you.
That's all for this edition of Metro Matters. You can join the conversation on our blog at ridemetro.org. Follow us on Twitter or friend us on Facebook. I'm Mary Sitt. Thanks for watching.